I look at this, first of all, the thing that caught me was the eyes, because it looks like a mirror. So, you know, I'm looking at myself, I'm looking at someone's soul, not the color of their skin, not necessarily, there is no body, but just in their eyes. If you look at all of us in the eyes, you don't know who, I mean, you know who's who, but you might not necessarily know their race, and I think that's really, really big that you did that. I think that's my favorite part of the piece, but when I look at this guy, I see, you know, obviously my brother, I'm a black female, and the hood, and to most, he probably seems like a gangster or a stereotype, but to me, that looks like my brother, who's an amazing human being, and I think the fact that you put a crown on top of that, making him the king, despite what else is going on, is really big as well. I don't know. Like, if I talk too much about this piece, I'm going to get emotional.
I think we have time, and I think the piece actually deserves a lot of conversation. So let's go for it. Yeah.
The piece is much bigger than this class, I think. When we walk off of Pepperdine's campus, it's a lot more than just, you know, not even men. Like, a woman was just killed in jail. And to me, like, today is the last day I'm here. And I feel safe here. But when I walk off campus, I don't know what can happen to me because of the color of my skin. And I know I'm an amazing person, but they don't take the time to look at you and see who you are. And my life could be gone tomorrow. You know, I don't know. And it's just because I'm African American. And I think that a lot of people won't be able to understand, like, how impactful this piece is, just to look at this and look at the effort you put into this piece and the pieces that you did in class for African American culture doing is so big, to introduce this to everyone and let them see almost inside of us. You know, this is your piece, but I feel like it represents me as well. And I'm so grateful that you did this and that this is my last day. I get to end on something as spectacular than this because I'm so scared. I'm so scared for what my future holds, not because I'm not talented, not because I'm not smart, not because I don't have a degree, but because I'm African American. And like Kendrick said in the lyrics, I have a big nose and nappy hair, and that's just something that's gonna put me back in life. And it's so scary. It's really scary. And going off of what you said earlier about starting off as Martin Luther King and then ending on Malcolm X, I think I'm going through that as well. It's just a really big piece. I'm gonna stop talking now.
No, keep going. Talk. You should keep going. This is your moment, you know.
No.
You've gone through 4 years here,
yeah,
and you have your whole life ahead of you. You know, so it's important. It's important for everyone to hear, you know, how you feel. This is really important, you know. So take the stage and just keep going.
That's how I feel. I mean, I feel scared. I like the question marks because to me, I'm not sure what you meant to portray. It's like, why? Like, why am I less than you are? Look into my soul. I'm the same as you. We have the same God. We follow the same things, but you ridicule me and you put me in this chair and you convict me. I see I'm not sure if it's blood or what it is dripping, and it's just like, you're killing me for what? Why am I latched into this chair? Is it because I have a hood on? You know, I really like the crown because it makes me think, like, regardless of what the world thinks, regardless of who everybody else sees, he's still a king. And when all this is over, when we all die, it doesn't matter if we were black or white or Asian or Hispanic, whatever we are, we're a king, queens, prince, and princesses in God's eyes. And it really it matters because we have to live it, but it does make us stronger. I don't know, this is a really, it's crazy. I wasn't expecting this. But yeah, it's crazy that you did this, because like I said, like, this is my last day in security. And Pepperdine, I don't know if everyone realizes how closed off Pepperdine is, how unrealistic it is to be here, like this own little island, we're our own community. But for me, when I step off this campus, I'm no longer Robbie Mayberry, the basketball player who is kind-hearted and nice and blah, blah, blah. I'm an African-American female, and point blank period, when I fill out a resume, they ask for that. And it's scary because of what's going on, and it scares me that I won't get the same job as someone with another qualification. Like, why is that on an application, you know? I don't know, it's so many, there's so many things I can say, but yeah. I'm gonna give someone else the floor if that's okay.
Okay.
I think it's great that you, you know, had the courage and bravery to do this piece and put it out there for us. You know, I moved to America a year ago, and you see the headlines, you see it on social media, you think it's being talked about, but this is the first time since I moved here that it's been in front of me and discussed. You know, people don't talk about it, and that's just, you know, what I've experienced since I've come here. It's an issue that's not being dealt with, and that terrifies me. Like, the, you know, I don't want to go too much into the presentation yet either, but, you know, the Sandy Bland thing, it's nauseating, it's, you can't believe it. Like, even, you know, I come from South Africa, we had apartheid, and, you know, it was really bad there, but I don't want to say it's better, but the amount of brutality that still exists in America and hatred, it's just so much more alive here in everyday life. As far as the piece goes, you know, before seeing the presentation, you know, what I thought to myself is it's a modern day crucifixion that's basically happening on a daily basis here. And I can't believe that that's the world. We live in this world. Yeah, that's almost.
I took it from the piece, including the presentation, on the master, the mouth is taped and it says we're all created equal, but it seems like, personally, I feel like blacks are now, especially with the eyes as like mirrors, a creation of society. You know, society created blacks into whatever they see it as, and like, you know, the more you tell somebody they are something, the more they're gonna become like that. And, you know, society tells blacks, you know, pretty much, you're a prisoner, you don't have your own voice, you know, who are you, is the question that blacks ask themselves, you know, without even really knowing it. But the fact that you put a crown on that, I think is really powerful because, you know, it shows hope and potential because, you know, we are kings, you know, each and every one of us, not only blacks, not only whites, but whatever else, whatever you are, you know, you still have the potential to rise up to be something that, you know, society tells you to be, or something even more than, you know, what they say you are. So, powerful piece.
Yeah, it's very powerful. I feel a lot of, like, emotion, and I think the crown, I think you did your presentation on Basquiat, I don't know how to say it, but the crown, I know that
mm-hmm.
Yeah, that really impacted you, so I can see the crown in that, and it just makes me feel really heavy-hearted and sad, and it's something that I don't fully understand, and that's what makes me really sad, too, is because, like what Robbie said, like when you look into someone's eyes, like it's just like all these things that people feel, like just at the core, why is it based off of a skin color? It really upsets me. And I look at, and I think I remember the like hood of, like the hoods up for Trayvon and like the whole basketball teams, like that's what I thought of when I saw the hood. And the whole piece in general made me think of the film Fruitvale Station. And that was really powerful, and it's also just, you know, it's a cool thing that art is such a form of getting to, like, really impact people in this, and I just, like, have so much respect and commend you for this piece, because it can really make a difference. It, like, it's probably making a difference in all of us right now in this class. And it's, I like to, I don't know if I liked it, but the in the film there was like old photos of the slavery, and then also how it's just like it's the same thing of what's happening right now. Like, there's an exact correlation. In my film class, we watched 12 Years a Slave, and then through, and it's just the same. Obviously different, but the premise of it, and there like has to be like it has to change, and it's because of like pieces like this and the conversation that this can bring. That I know what you're saying of why you wanted to hear this, because when you see the progression in this, like, you'll have this, and you've commented on everyone else's piece, and you're always like, this is powerful, but this is so powerful. I have chills, and I feel emotional, but it's really powerful and really well done, and it's really going to make a difference, and it's also just sick. Like, it just looks cool, like, the way that, like, just the premise and, like, how much hard work you put into building that chair and everything. It's, you always, like, stood out to me in this class for, like, just really having an artistic ability and a sort of power and essence in this, and it's just been cool to see, and I really appreciate it.
Yeah, I know me and Robbie have, in our social classes, we've always talked about stuff like this, and what I thought about right away is, like, those images, all the images that you showed would have been so much more powerful 5 years ago, but because of social media and the way everything's just being so polarized and so just, it's just numbing, like, everyone's just numb, like, those images that you showed now, like, it's no longer, like, I don't know how to explain it, like, people are so used to seeing this nowadays, and that's, like, the terrible thing about it. Like, you should not be used to seeing stuff like this. And it's just, like the idea, like, I know if I go on Facebook, I will see something political right now. And just, like, the idea of, like, armchair activism and all of this, like, makes people so polarized that, like, it affects, it goes from being a human, like, human right to live, and the idea of being free and the ability of, like, going after what you want, to making people just turn against each other. And I think kind of Kendrick hits it on that song, and that's why I love that song so much, is, like, he's talking about all the race issues and everything, but at the end of the song he says, at the end of the day, I'm killing someone that's darker than me. And I think that is so powerful, just the idea that because of how society is treating people in general, African Americans, but a ton of other races as well, just in general, people are turning on each other, and I don't think that's what it should be like. As in case of, like, the art, I think it no matter what race you are, this hits on you. If you're a female, I mean, you can see, like, looking yourself in the mirror, you can see yourself sitting there just because you're a woman rather than a man. And I think just the characteristics of being human in this society that we live in today, where everything has to be so perfect, and you have to be this perfect tone, and you have to be this perfect weight, and this perfect size, and this perfect, everything has to be so perfect, and everything revolves around something that is so fake, that I think that when you look at yourself in the mirror and, like, read that all men are created equal, I see that as a way of kind of mocking what society is today, and that essentially no one is equal, no one can be happy with themselves because they're not perfect. And, you know, I think people should be more into learning about others as a person rather than skin color. And I think because of all this social media and everything that is going on, people are not willing to sit down and talk. Like, you can't go and sit down with some, like, I don't know, like, it's just so hard to sit down and talk with someone that's so opposite of your views because of everything that's happening right now. And I think that is what's killing us as a society. And I think, I mean, and that's why I love living in LA and California in general, just because there's so much progression happening, whether it's not apparent right now, but, like, if we were in the South, this art piece would not have been shown. Like, you would have shown it, but there would have been so much backlash. And I think that puts the power of this piece, because it shows that while we aren't where we need to be, there will be, like, I'm hopeful. I'm very hopeful for everything. But at the same time, it's just, for me personally, the way I see it is, social media is just destroying us, and it's creating monsters out of humane people. And touching on the issue of, like, killings and stuff, that's why that's very close to me, because, like, I've always been so strong in the idea that the people that are protecting our country should be more educated. And I'm not saying the cops aren't, but I think that there should be requirements for, I've always said a bachelor's degree should be the least of what a cop should get. That's my political, I'm sorry, I'm a political science sociology double major, so this just is everything that I struggle with. And yeah, I mean, like I said, I see myself in this piece too, just like, I don't know if you guys heard of, like, the Donald Trump comments about Mexicans and that they're rapists. And me personally, the way I see it, I don't take offense to that, personally, because I look at where I started off and I look at where I am today in life, and I see the progression I made and how the sky's the limit. And that's sort of, this kind of art piece and this live shows kind of motivates me, and I think it should motivate everyone, that no matter, if you just put your mind to it and you work hard, you can, I know, nothing in life will be easy. And I think Dr. Gillis has stated this before, that if life was easy, it's not, I personally don't think it's a meaningful life. And I think that you having the guts to present this and show this and show this is who you are, and this is what you stand for, and this is what you want to fight for, I'm hopeful that things will change, because of people that have, for lack of better words, the balls to present something like this and show stuff like this. So, I don't know, I think this is a very powerful piece. I think everyone in their own struggles can relate to this art piece, not necessarily slideshow, but this art piece, and I think that I am very hopeful, and I hope things will change. But I think this is the kind of settings where things will change in a higher educational institute, where people are not scared to talk. Obviously, like Robbie said, it is scary. The world is scary, because you'll never know how people will see you. The 1% is what controls 80% of what we experience in life every day. So, I don't know. There's so much that goes into your head with this. When it comes to the art itself, the way I see it is, the crown, I see it as, like, we're killing someone that could be so influential as a king would be, without actually giving him the opportunity to live that out. The hood speaks a lot to me, because I love dressing, like, I don't know, I just grew up, you know, with the sagging pants, double XL shirts and stuff like that, and it's been such a transition coming into Pepperdine, somewhere like this where it's a lot more conservative, and just the change of dress style, like, the way you dress, people will judge you based on that, and I try to stay away from changing the way I dress, but I think that's the hardest thing, is, like, you will be judged by the way you dress, and that's something that you have to be conscious about, and that, the hood itself just speaks to me for that, because wearing the jacket or the sweater and putting the hood on and not putting the hood on can be the difference between you being considered a thug or a criminal and you being considered a college kid. It literally can be the difference.
So do you think that you should continue to wear the hood, or that they shouldn't wear the hood? Or
I mean, that's
an interesting point to talk about, like the symbolism of a black hood and what that means. Is that, what do you think about that? You know, like, should Should it be more used to make that change, or?
I think that's what's causing the problem, though. I honestly think
the black, the dress.
No, not the dress. Just
the fact that people have to take off the hood to break that stereotype is the problem. I don't think the hood is actually the problem. I don't think people should start wearing it more or wearing them less. I think the problem is the judgment. There shouldn't be any consideration. If Mario should be able to dress in sweatpants and a hoodie and
right.
still be able to be looked at as a educated man,
yeah.
but you can't. And it has a lot to do with race as well. It's not just the hood, since Mario
yeah.
is a Mexican-American now.
And I was blessed to have light skin.
Yeah.
Honestly, that's a blessing. And I you know, obviously, once, and that's where I think things come into play, because even though I have light skin, people always see me as white, but once they start hearing me talk and like
mm-hmm.
talk about me and stuff, then that's when they start categorizing me as Mexican. And I think that just goes into show, like, it's not so much it obviously it is skin color, but I think it's also where you're culturalized and socialized. I think that goes into effect, like, you know, like Robbie said, she dark skin woman from Oakland, like that itself is gonna create tons of problems. Like, even if you were just from Oakland by yourself, that would create problems no matter where you go. And so I don't, it's so much more complex than you know, it's like there's no just one way of fixing it. It's something that needs to be changed completely. And the problem is, and I'm going on a rant. I'm so against social media and like social media, like politics and like.
Yeah,
you know.
Nobody apologize anymore
yeah.
for speaking your mind in
yeah.
here. This is so important. So take your time. You know, we
yeah,
have
I mean,
time with this. Yeah.
I just think it's I'm so frustrated because social media just destroys any progress. Like, yes, you can like something a million times, 2 million times, but what is that's gonna bring awareness to it, but it's not gonna actually cause a change. Yes, it's gonna bring, you know, people can donate money, I understand that, but I can donate as much money as I want to any foundation, that doesn't mean that's gonna cause change. Like, people have to be willing to change. And, you know, it's hard. It's something that's very hard. It's very difficult. I
agree. It is changing the culture because people will post a photo on Instagram and think they're active in the movement, whereas Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, they're on my mind just because Julian was talking about them. They went out and made the movement happen. But nowadays, we think it's enough to post a picture or say Black Lives Matter or just little things like that. I really do agree with you. We are just desensitized, and it almost seems as if we are becoming very lazy and relying on social media way, 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 way too much. People, I'm not gonna go into that. Has nothing to do with that. But yeah, I agree with you.
I do, though. Not, I agree, but I mean, my eyes have been open. Like, some of the videos I've seen of these, like, policemen and, like, when, like, people are just filming them, like, the guy that was suffocated on the street for just, like, sitting there, I forget his name, but, like, that had power to me. Like, even though this was just via social media, that opened my eyes, and now that I'm much more aware of, like, what's happening and what, like, and getting to see those things. And it's, for me, it is, I get what you're saying. But it is creating awareness. But yes, there should be the next,
mm-hmm.
like, there should be more. But it is creating awareness. I don't want to completely, but I also agree. But
yeah.
to an extent, there is some level of, I don't know, good to be taken from.
What do you think, Iris? Heavy day, I know. Well, you got a lot to think about there and bring in your feelings.
I hope you guys don't look at me differently after I say this, but like, this makes me feel like uncomfortable. Just because I'm not black or white. And growing up, I feel like issues like this, I lived with the saying of like, ignorance is bliss, you know? And I feel like being Asian and like, aside from being Asian American, being Asian, like how I was brought up, my parents immigrated here, so they did carry over their how conservative they are and how traditional they are, and without me knowing, like that's how I was raised. And for me, like when there's issues that are very controversial and like has a lot of discussion, like, we don't talk about stuff like that. You know, we just kind of, if it doesn't involve us, we don't involve ourselves in it, kind of thing.
Wait, you came out. Your parents came out from China or Taiwan?
No, they're Korean. So.
Oh, that.
Yeah.
Of course.
Korean. I mean,
I'm just thinking Lee.
Yeah.
Lee is like, I know a lot of Taiwanese with the last name Lee.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it kind of keeps throwing me off.
Yeah. So whenever I hear things like shootings happening in the news, like, I mean, I do sympathize, like, a little bit. Like, it's not like I'm like, oh, Patty was bad. Like, I don't ever think like that. And it's horrible what happens. But for me, like, I don't know how to process it. And so I suppress it, like, when I see things like this. And, like, I'm, like, glad that you brought this issue up in class, you know, because, just through your artwork, like I'm like kind of reflecting like where do I stand in this kind of issue, like as an Asian American, not like what could I do, but like by me not saying anything, am I helping the situation really, or am I making it worse? You know, and that's like not just me specifically, but other people who may feel like we're in the same position as me, and. I think I feel like this sometimes, just because I feel like it's not relatable to me, just because it's race that's the issue, and it's my thing about it kind of sucks that's my reasoning, you know, and that's what the problem is in the end. So I don't know, I feel really like.
I appreciate your input.
And it's not like I'm like taking sides, you know, and I do want to like know more about issues like this, you know, because I am American and this is happening to America. Like I should take pride in that, and I should, you know, like I think it's crazy how like some people don't know anything about the country, and like in situations like this, like that's how I feel. And because I'm American, like that should be part of my identity when issues like this comes up, and when there are other people who are the same nationality as me having to deal with issues like this, when I don't have to necessarily deal with it every day, you know, like I don't necessarily walk out off campus thinking that like I'm going to be pinpointed because I'm Asian. Like I don't feel that. Like I try to walk comfortably. I try not to feel like my race, my ethnicity is what defines me, because I'm not Korean. Like I don't speak the language even. You know, like I don't have anything related to that. So I don't know. I think like it hurts me to like see things like this and. It makes me feel bad that like I'm kind of being like a bystander in it all, but I don't know how to like react. So
I was just not to call you out at all, but you know, I think the beauty of this piece is that you can relate to it. You know what I mean? Like especially with the mirrors in the eye, like you've gone through personal struggles, whether it may not be as blown up or you know your people in the past, wherever you're from. Like everybody here has been through their personal struggles. So I think the beauty of this piece is to be able to relate yourself and put yourself. Not really in the same shoes, but to see the background and see that, you know, everybody comes from the same, you know, we're all made of the same fabric, you know what I'm saying? Like, you've gone through your own struggles, whether it be social constructs or, you know, somebody sees you as Asian, oh, she must be smart, you know what I'm saying? Like, even whether that little or big it is, you can still relate to it in your own way, you know what I'm saying? So, I say don't see yourself as like a bystander, but kind of see yourself as like, somebody who's gone through something similar, so you should be able to, you know, kind of see yourself in that piece, you know? Like, I feel like everybody should be able to see yourself in that piece. And I think the beauty of that is that, I think that's what Jordan's going for. I mean, I don't know, but, you know, you should be able to kind of put yourself in those own shoes, like, you know, black, white, Asian, Mexican, whatever. You know, you should kind of be able to see yourself in that kind of spot.
But I think she like, when she was talking, I literally said, I was thinking hashtag goals. Like, that's literally what our goal is in as a society. Like, you should have that mindset. Like, she, when she walks in the street, she doesn't even have to think she's Asian. She looks at any, she's American. Like, that's what society should be like. She, like she said, she's not connected to Korea. She doesn't have, like, she doesn't speak language. Like, that's what society should be like. Like, you shouldn't, like, just because you're darker skinned than I am, you shouldn't be scared. Like, you should be walking the street knowing that you're an American. Like, everyone should be able to just walk in the street being, like, and I think that's the issue, that you can't, like, right now, as of how things are right now, you just can't. And it's like, we have to all find a way to come together, and if we see someone else struggling, or see someone else, like, fearing their lives, like, if somebody says that fear walking out of their house, because they don't know they're going to be able to come back home, like, we have to come together and find a way to make that person feel at home, because they're home, like, they live in, you're living in America, you're, no matter how long you've been living here, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, no matter who you are, what you live, what you do for a living, like, at the end of the day, you should be able to feel, like, obviously, if you're doing bad things and, you know, walking around, doing whatever, like, you know, then, yeah, you should have fear, but if you're just doing yourself and doing what you have to do to survive and provide for your family, you should not have to fear, you know, the color. And I think that, like, what she said literally is what we should strive for. We're not in, like, in our talk, but, like, in just society in general, like, we're, everyone is being more defensive of who they are rather than seeing what the other person is struggling with and helping them. Like, everyone's being more protective of, like, oh, well, you want to take our guns? Like, no, this is, like, our right to have guns, you know? Or, like, whatever the argument is. Like, everyone is shying away. Like, everyone has, like, kind of that block where, like, they don't want others, like, they don't want to see the other person's viewpoint. They just want to see their own viewpoint and express that viewpoint. And I think that is what the biggest issue out of all of this is, that we're not trying to help each other out. We're trying to protect ourselves where we are at in life right now. And I think that it is what needs to change. It's my last thing I'm going to say. I'm done.
Jared, you haven't spoken yet. You're an excellent listener, observing everyone. What's happening?
Oh, no. I usually, Jack made me think. He said, like, he'd been here a year. This is the first time that it's really been in his face. And I thought, where I was raised, I've lived here for 22 years, and this is the first time it's been really in my face. And think about that, like, that really sucks. That, you know, this is, like, and it made me just admire you a lot, Julian, because, I don't know, everyone's getting kind of real, so I guess I'll get kind of real. I always feel like these, when this stuff shows up, like, especially this very poignant and very, like, powerful artistic expression, like, I can see, like, just it's super powerful, and, like, you put yourself into it, and, it's like, I don't know, it's really tough for me to talk about, and I'm glad everybody else kind of got, you know, a little bit real, but, like, I always feel like I just want to sink into the walls when this kind of stuff gets brought up, because I feel like the big white elephant in the room. So I'm just, you know, like, sometimes I feel like I can't talk about it. Like, I can't say anything because, like, almost like, I mean, it's stupid, but, like, I feel like I'm, you know, I'm the bad guy now that we watch that, which is, I know it's ridiculous, but it just, I don't know, if you can't tell me, like, it's just weird. I don't know. It's not something I was raised to be, like, engaged with. But at the same time, it's something that I desperately want to be engaged with. I want to figure it out. I was almost just going to raise my hand and ask a question, like, so, like, what do I do now? You know, like, what do I do is, like, the good old boy from Ohio. Like, I'm just pretty, I'm like as white as you can get. And like, where does it leave me? You know what I mean? Like, I just don't know. It's hard to deal with because I can't. Like, does that make sense? Everybody kind of gets me? Like, I feel like. Yeah, so I mean, I'm really glad that you brought this up, and I'm really glad that I'm here today and I'm here now, because like I can't not think about it now. You know what I mean? I can't just kind of like back home, you just say like, oh well, you know, that sucks, and I feel for those people, but I don't want to think about it because then I might have to, you know, go out on a limb and change my behavior or change my like how I do. So first of all, I just want to thank you for like bringing it to everybody. Especially me, I think about this stuff a lot, and it's always like I'm clueless. So, if you guys have any input for just, I mean, everybody, but it's just, yeah, it's really hard to think about sometimes. Like, really hard to like just know how to react. I want to know like what is the right thing to say to this, because mm-hmm. it's a, yeah. So,
I mean, damn, I said I didn't know I was going to say anything, but I think, I'm not trying to put word into, like, Julian's work, but I think that is the whole point of this.
Yeah.
I think that's exactly the whole point of this, like, that some people, I mean, I'm not African American, but, you know, when I go back home, it's a lot different than being at Pepperdine, and I think that a lot of people at Pepperdine grew up in this kind of, like how you said, like, that kind of environment where you don't have, like, and I think that's the beauty of it, like, I think that's what we all want to accomplish. Like, we don't have to. You don't have to worry about things like this. Like, these things are things that humans should not have to worry about in our society. And just you being aware of that and noticing that, I think that's the whole point of this, is understanding that, you know, some people, while you have your own struggles, a lot of people have other struggles that they have to deal with that you probably never had noticed before. But yeah, I think that's.
What I think is interesting is like, you kind of took on the viewpoint of the oppressed, which is like looking to the eyes, because you are a white man. But when the subject comes up, you feel like you can't say anything because everyone is judging you because you fit a stereotype, which I think is perfect for what you said, because it's the same thing. Like, it's not just, I think a misinterpretation a lot of the times is that we make it a race of white versus blacks. No, it's the stereotype between that. It's not white versus blacks. And I think that I'm really happy you said that, and I have a lot of respect for you saying that, because it is the truth. Like, you feel uncomfortable because you fit a stereotype, and it makes me relate to you because I feel uncomfortable as well because I fit one. And I don't know, I just want to commend you for saying exactly what you feel, because it brought light to the entire class.
I feel like I don't like it, like you said, like I'm worried of what I could say to be, but I feel like the problem though comes from like this concept of like white supremacy, and I feel like I have to. Like, if there is going to be a change, like, I feel like I have to be a big part. Do you know what I'm saying? Like,
mm-hmm.
I feel like, that one picture really stuck to me. It was really powerful of, like, the one white man and then the one black man, and he was like, is his life more valuable than mine? Like, I feel like we aren't speaking up about it enough, and partly because of how, like, Jerry feels of, like, oh, but shit, like, I'm the reason almost. Or, like, not reason, but, like, I feel guilty. Like, I feel guilty that I get to walk on the street and not be afraid. Like, that makes me upset. Like, why? Like, why is it that way? And then I feel like I don't want to act like, oh, I'm the only one that could make the difference. But, like, I feel like it's just a really hard thing. Like, it's hard. It's, like, a hard thing to, and I'm not trying to make this about me, but you know what I'm saying? It just is such a, it's, like, up to, it makes me feel like it's up to, like, yeah, it just makes me feel like I have to do something if there's going to be, because I feel like after all this time, why is there still not, you know?
It's like, it's not enough to not be the racist black cop, you know what I mean? Like, that's...
I think it's,
Like, is
I didn't cut you off.
Well, like, I'm just saying, like, watching it, like, that feeling of guilt, it's not so much guilt, but it's like, what? Like, all right, I'm on this, like, let's go. But, like, it's not enough just to not be, like, feeding that. Like, it's like, almost like with the social media thing, like, there's another step. And it's like, what's the step for, like, for me right now? You know what I'm saying? Like, how do I not just not contribute to the bad, but contribute to the good?
I think not contributing to the bad is contributing, in my opinion. Like, the fact that you just said that, you've done your part. You know what I mean? That's what we want as Americans. And I don't think you should have to feel like it's your, not necessarily that it's your battle to fight, but that you have to do something more than thinking of all people equal, because you've already reached what you needed to do. So what I would say to you is I hope you never feel like that again, because I think you've done your part. I honestly do think that. And I want to say that just because I am African American, maybe like by saying that to you, it holds more value than hearing it from someone else. But I really do think you've already done your part, and you shouldn't feel that you're obligated to do something else. And I don't feel that it has to come from you for a change to happen. I feel like you've already made the change. Now it's up to another person to make that change and feel the same way that you do, and then the world will come to peace. But I commend you for saying that, like I said before, too.
You feel all right, maybe?
Julian, do you want to take some time and just talk, or do you feel
that? Absolutely.
So I guess I'll start by talking about the piece, and then I'll kind of get into the philosophical and sociological aspects of it. So when coming up with this idea, it was like, when she mentioned what the project was, it was boom, this is what I want to do. And there were variations of it, but this is kind of the end result, but I wanted it to be something like this. And for the most part, I would say most of the pieces on here have more than one meaning, especially when you get around this head area. We can just start at the top. Like, everybody really understood the meaning of the crown, the meanings of the crown, because there's more than one. If you notice, it's the highest point of the piece of art. So above all, we are kings and queens. And that's everybody, every race. In the eyes of the Lord, I feel like, you know, one human being's life is the same as someone else's. And we all have the same potential and the same capability to be kings and queens and to be great people. And then also the resemblance to Basquiat. He did have an impact on my outtake. And when I found the crown, I was like, this is perfect. This is perfect. And then another meaning, forget, I think it might have been Jacques. I'm not sure. Somebody mentioned, maybe it was Chandler, I'm not sure. Somebody mentioned that that the crown also symbolizes, and this is what I thought of, that that you could be potentially killing somebody who has this beauty and this potential inside of them. Like, somebody who's destined for greatness is being put down for reasons that are unjust. And that's another kind of purpose to the crown. As a whole, I mean, it is an electric chair. That was the kind of thing I was going for, and Jacques, you hit right on the head of the nail. It is the modern day execution. I couldn't have said it any better. That was perfect. I mean, I can't even speak on it. That was just perfect. That's exactly what it is. The biggest piece of this artwork is the eyes. That meant everything to me. The eyes have so many different meanings. One, when you look into it, you see yourself. So you have the opportunity to put yourself in that position. Whether you're not really familiar with the issue, whether you live the issue, whether you don't really know how you should respond to the issue, you can put yourself in that situation and say, okay, this is happening. Whether I acknowledge it or not, whether I know about it or not, whether I choose to do something or not, this is happening. This impacts people. What can I do? Or what am I doing? Or what should I do better? Or what should I not do? Or just, there's so many questions, which is why the chair is covered in question marks. You look into the eyes and you see yourself. Are you doing this to somebody without even knowing it?
are you living this life? Like, how do you contribute to this? Like, I wanted you to see yourself. I want you to see yourself as this person. Like, what is this person going through? It's not because his skin is brown. I mean, that was meant to reflect the fact that it's a minority. But the point is that I want you to see yourself and put yourself in that position and say, why is this happening? And how long is it going to be before it spreads to another group? Because it happens to everybody. It's not just black people. It's not just Mexican Americans. It's not just, you know, Asian Americans. It's not just poor people. It's not just middle class. It's not just working class. Like, it's everybody. Everybody deals with something. And I feel like everybody touched on that. Everybody has their own personal struggles. So this is not just a race piece. This is a society. Like, this is you. Like, it's, I don't know. The eyes, if I could take everything away, I would just leave the eyes. That was everything to me. And then if you work your way down a little bit, you see the duct tape across the face, and it says all men are created equal. This is a concept that our society was founded on, this country was founded on, and it's a joke. Since the moment we got here, no one was created equal or treated equal. The country was built off of injustice and inequality. It's a joke. It's bullshit. Nobody, it's not true. It's just not true. And to speak out against it, every time it just gets stifled. Nobody takes it seriously, or you get killed in the process. That's why it's over his mouth, because this is a concept that we came here and talked about, but it was never lived. It's never been put into action. And that's why it's always going to remain stifled unless we look into those eyes and ask ourselves what we can do to help advance this progression that I see in everybody. Everybody here has shown me that they have the appropriate mindset or some take on this that can lead to a better world tomorrow. It's it's tough. It's a tough piece. It's just tough for me to really work on. I mean, the there are certain aesthetic choices that I made that highlighted stuff, like the blood spatter. I mean, it runs down the handrails, like, because it is killing us as a society, not just one race, not just one person. It's killing our society, kind of like Amari was talking about. Like, this is why we are falling. There's just so many different aspects to this piece that were really impacting me. And then the presentation, man, you guys, like the talk about social media, Mario, you especially touched on that. Is social media is such, it's so amazing what we can do. I can take my phone out and text somebody or hit somebody up on Facebook or Instagram, and they get that picture instantly. And I mean, you were talking about how it helps spread the message. It is probably the best tool that we have today. It's probably the strongest tool that we have. We can reach people across this floating rock in space. We can reach anybody that we want to. But it doesn't stop there. It's not about who we can show this picture to. What are we going to do once we see it? Jacques, you mentioned that this was the first time that it had really been brought to your attention. Jared, so did you. Like, once it gets brought to your attention, what do we do? Where do we go from here? Everybody. Like, I would like to wake up one day and see all of my brothers and sisters, no matter what color you are, and say, you are the exact same as me, and you will be treated the exact same. And I love you for every reason that I love myself. I don't know. That's a tough issue. I live my life like this. My mom is white. Like, I grew up, and people asked me if I was adopted. Nobody thought that was my mom. And nobody understood why she would want a black baby. And and it's rough because you get treated differently while you're a kid, because kids don't understand. If they're raised the wrong way, then they don't understand why you're different. Is your skin dirty? Like, are you not clean because you have darker skin? These are things that I heard when I was little, man, and it's like, we haven't come that far. Like, it's still just a problem. We've grown, but we're not nearly where we should be as a society. As far as we've advanced in all these other different areas, we still can't treat another human being equally. And I mean, I guess that's the real point of this piece, is just the question marks. Because everybody can ask themselves some question. You know? Like, what do I do? Who am I? What type of person am I? How can I help this issue? How can I be a part of this? Because from what I heard from everybody in here, nobody likes this. Nobody likes what's going on. No one approves of it. So what are we gonna do? Even if it was something just as simple as uplifting your brother or sister, not literally your brother or sister, but another human being, like, you see somebody who's being put down for any reason, lift them up. It's like, it's not even a race thing, it's just caring for your fellow man. Very simple, very simple. And yet it seems to be one of the most difficult things for our society to do. And I'm not saying everybody needs to go out and be the next Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. or the next Malcolm X, because it's just, as you can see, you try to do something like that and you get taken out. But that doesn't mean that that should stop us from wanting to do something. Whether it's, you know, just standing up for any piece of injustice that you see, or just treating somebody better. It's the life that we live right now. This is the world that we're in. And we can either choose to reside in it or be active in it.
So why don't we applaud before I speak?